everybody. Thanks for coming. It's nice to see so many people came today. I think I talk about it a lot, but we're really going to have to get a new room. It's getting a little big. Today we have a very, very excellent presentation about Inkscape, which is a drawing program. Now, in my courses, I tell them most of the time I spend in my work is drawing pictures and thinking about things. And every paper I write, I have to make schematic diagrams, drawings of something like this. And up to now, I use PowerPoint, but after seeing what Eleonora has to show you today, I'm going to use this because it's a lot like PowerPoint, but better. So check it out, and I won't talk anymore, so here's Eleonora.
Thank you. Yeah, thank you for the invitation to give this seminar today. Hi everyone, and thanks for coming. I didn't really expect that many people. So if you can't hear me, just let me know. I was thinking a lot about how to make a presentation about a drawing program, right? How would I show it meaningfully, and also have a file for you to have afterwards that you can download and have the things. And so I decided to do the presentation in Inkscape. But Inkscape is a drawing program, not a presentation program, so it's not going to be as streamlined as normal presentations are. And I will also have to sit a lot because I'll be just clicking around and showing you stuff. So sorry to the people in the back, but you're not interested in seeing me, right? So just a interesting thing. I said that Inkscape is not a presentation program, but I just learned about an extension that allows you to make it into a presentation afterwards, your picture, and you can zoom through, similar to Prezi. I haven't tried it out. It's a new feature. So maybe someone will have a next seminar. I'm also not an expert on Inkscape, but I use it for all the drawings and all the figures I make. So I'll just show you how I use it and the simple things. So if there are any experts here, then sorry. So I guess I'll sit down and start. So here we are. I will start with a little introduction to Inkscape, what it is, and why it's an interesting thing for us scientists to learn about. I will give you a quick tour of the features and how to use them. The most important are shapes and paths. Don't worry, I'll zoom into everything. So this is just, and then I'll show you how I use Inkscape. So first, let's start with what is Inkscape and why would we want to use it? Well, Inkscape is a drawing program. And as Brian was saying, I was so surprised how much time I spend on figures doing science, right? There's always a need for figures, diagrams, schematics, posters, presentations, and you want the pictures to look good, right? And not to take too much effort, and paint doesn't usually cut it. So Inkscape is a scalable vector graphics editor. For those who would want to follow this presentation and try some of the things in Inkscape, I'll start with where you can download it, which is this simple website, right? Or if you Google Inkscape, you'll get to the official Inkscape page, and then you have the download. So it's multi-platform, free, and open source, which is quite nice. Quite nice. Yeah, it's actually also on the NTNU program farm, so you don't even need to install it right now if you want to try it out. It's a scalable vector graphics editor, which means that it deals with vectors instead of pixel images. So let's see what that means. Here we have two smiley faces. Do you see any difference between them? No. All right. Now, if I zoom in, and you're probably starting to see the difference. So the one on the left, I drew here in Inkscape. The one on the right is a picture that I took that one that I drew. I exported it as a JPEG and imported it back. And you see that this one is composed of pixels, and it has a limited resolution. So you can't zoom in forever. But the Inkscape objects, they're not saved as the values for the pixels, but they're saved as geometrical shapes, the vectors, which also means that for most pictures, it will be a smaller file, unless it's crazy complicated. So that means that you can easily rescale your graphics if you find out that you need a better resolution if you want to put it on a poster or into paper or anything. So that's the vector graphics. Apparently, it's similar to Adobe Illustrator, which I haven't used, so I can't really say. And I haven't used it because it's a bit more difficult to get to it, right? I do think that Antenu has some license, but it's also not for everyone. It's not automatic, so it's but both of these programs have a little bit of a learning bump. I'm not even going to call it a learning curve, because it's not really that difficult. It's just, I guess many people have the same thing as I did when I first opened it and I was going to use it, and I was like, okay, how do I make a line? And I was like, okay, I'll just close it and use PowerPoint, right? But then then after looking up a few things, you get into it, and then it's quite easy. And just to show you how powerful this can be, I have a few pictures that I just found by Googling. And these are pictures made by artists and graphic designers in Inkscape. So this one on the left, that still kind of feels like, yeah, I can get behind that. Someone drew it. But this thing, I wouldn't believe that's not a photograph. But apparently it took 350 hours of work. So that's like, I don't know, 10-ish weeks if you work 8 hours a day, 5 days a week. I don't think I would want that job, but it's pretty cool.
Especially if you
can take a photo. Yeah, if you... Yeah. But yeah, there's more. I mean, I like this last one. It looks like it's painted, like actual. Well, they're pretty good. Well, that's not what I'm going to show you, obviously. I can't do this. But what I can do, and what I do using Inkscape, is I make all of my figures. And I use it for schematics. These two top ones, they're similar. So it doesn't really matter that much. That's the first proper figure I actually made in Inkscape. I'm still proud of it. I often use it to put together plots from MATLAB with pictures from a microscope, or just when I need to put in a lot of figures from MATLAB together. You can also easily set the setting for dots per inches, which you might know that journals often ask for a specific dots per inch to get the correct publication quality. And I also made a poster in Inkscape, my first and only poster. There's still too much text in it, but that's not the fault of Inkscape, right? So you have images that I had from the microscope with some overlaid plots, and I think I annotated this in Inkscape. This figure was made in Inkscape here. Flowchart made in Inkscape. Again, some imported plots from MATLAB. And I mean, I guess it's a decent layout, right? Shouldn't praise myself too much, but I'm still not too horrible. All right, but we'll get back to that. So you're probably asking yourself now, how do I use this, right? So let's start with a little tour of the basic features. So I'll talk a bit about the interface, then I'll tell you about the shapes and the paths. All right. There's one, yeah, this is a bit of a overview of different things we can have here. So one thing I usually like to do is that I switch on a grid. You just go to view. You probably can't see that well from the back, right? The tabs and everything, but that's why I wrote it here, like where you find stuff. But if we go to view, we can switch on page grid. And you have a grid, and all the objects can be set to snap to the corners, so it's easy to start making something from one corner to another corner, and then you can set the sizes as you want them. But for the presentation purposes, I think I switched that off. Looks better. Then an important thing that is good to know where it is the document properties under file. And there you have the different page sizes from the usual, you know, A4, A3, whatever, to custom size. That's also where you set the portrait and landscape. And you can always set all the sizes in pixels, centimeters, inches, whatever, pretty much whatever. Yeah, so that's that one. And then something that I'm really happy works so easily in Inkscape is saving things in other formats that can be submitted to journals, right? So you either just save it as, here we have all the different things. SVG is the native scalable vector graphics format that Inkscape works with, but you can also open that in web browsers. So if you don't have Inkscape, you can still view the images. Then of course you have PNGs and PDFs and a lot of other stuff that I don't even know what it is, so I'm not gonna go into that. But for example, if you go and try to save something as a PDF, it asks you for the resolution in dots per inch. So that the dreaded thing about publication quality figures, you can easily set it here. And you also have export PNG image. And then you can decide whether you're exporting just a drawing, a selection, or the page, the whole page. There you can also set the DPI, the dots per inch. So that makes it really easy. Yeah, another cool thing about Inkscape is that there are many keyboard shortcuts you can use. There are keyboard shortcuts for everything, and most of them you will be told when you hover over anything on the interface. Here you see them, all the different shortcuts. Or here, if you hover over something, it tells you also the keyboard shortcut. So, for example, just for the navigation, you can obviously use the wheel to scroll around, up and down, the usual stuff. If you hold shift, you scroll side to side. Control plus wheel, you zoom in and out. But you also have keyboard shortcuts for these things as well. I would want to introduce you to the most, I guess, the most important tool. You have the tools on the left, in this left bar or sidebar. And on top there is the what I guess they call selector. You can also switch to that by spacebar, which is a wonderful shortcut. And that is the thing that helps you select whatever objects you have. So if we have an object, then you just move it around. Yeah, I mean, it's quite simple. Yeah. And the last thing that I want to cover before we get to the tools is that you can have multiple layers in your drawings in Inkscape. And I've heard that some people are a bit nervous about that, but there's no reason to be. You have the list of layers on the bottom, and you can access all the layer commands in the layer tab up here, which allows you to add layer, move selections to different layers, move between layers, switch layers around, and so on. And the layers are nice if your drawings are a bit more complicated. I have to admit, I often work with one layer. But if you're making something more complicated and you, for example, have some outlines that you want to fit into, but you don't want to change them anymore, then you can just put it in like a bottom layer, lock that one, so that you can't edit it. Of course, you can unlock it later, but so that you don't accidentally change something, and then draw on top of it. And you can also make layers invisible. And so I have in this presentation, I have a secret layer that I'm gonna switch to now. That's the secret layer, but it's invisible. So I'm gonna switch it to visible. And I'm sorry for the terrible pun, but that's the secret layer. Yeah.
You can hide some nice Easter eggs in there.
Yeah, you can totally hide. If you export this, it's not going to be there if the layer is set to invisible, right? So I'll set it back to invisible because we don't need the secret layer. Obviously, there are better uses for them than Easter eggs. But yeah. All right. So that was just a couple of things that didn't really fit in under the other things. But let's start with is it big enough, or should I guess maybe I should zoom in a bit more so we can see? Is the font big enough? Can you see it? Yeah. All right, so in Inkscape, you have shapes and paths. Shapes are a bit more straightforward and more similar to what you're used to from PowerPoint or even Paint. So we'll start with that. And the basic ones are rectangles, ellipses, stars, and spirals. The stars and spirals are the cool stuff that you never use, but they're, yeah. So you have them on the left. And you just select whatever you want to make. So let's start with a rectangle. And then you just click. What have I done? Oh, I locked. I'm still in the secret layer and it's locked. Okay. I'll switch back to, actually I have a play layer just for the presentation. So that I don't mess up my main stuff while moving things around here. All right, so there's a rectangle. So you basically just make it by clicking and dragging, just like every other drawing program. But you can also, if you hold down control while you're dragging, it will stay a square and not a rectangle. I didn't know how to say it, that it just, I mean, because an ellipse will stay a circle. So yeah, that's with control. So now I can make squares quite easily. And if you shift and click and drag, it starts from the center. So if you want to place something in the center and not start from the corner. And this works equally well for circles. So here we have a circle. or an ellipse. Now I'll make a circle using control, and now a circle from the middle. Ooh. Right. All right. So now I'm gonna get rid of them. So I'll just select all of them by dragging a window around them and delete. So that's how you can select multiple things. An interesting thing is that all of these special shapes, they have their own handles. If you can see the tiny squares in the corners and the little circle, so the squares you can use to reshape. But now we can click to the or change to the selector tool as well, which is the arrow up there, and you see that the handles have changed. And they basically do the same thing here. But what if we have, if you click again, then you can rotate in the selector tool. But now let's have a look what happens if we make things, if we rescale in the selector tool this rotated rectangle. So you see that the selector rescales things in the left, right, top, bottom coordinates of the page. But if we go back to the rectangle tool and pull on this, it rescales it as the rectangle, which is quite nice when you're moving things around and then you want to make them bigger. You get the idea. So how these tools and handles work is different depending on if you're in the specific shape tool or if you're in the selector. And if you hold control, then you can keep either one dimension the same, that you only drag along one dimension. You have to be a little careful. Or the ratio should stay the same. Yeah, there we are. Yeah. And then each object will have a lot of other things you can do with it. So if we go to, there's an objects tab on the top. And for example, we have the transform. And then it opens here on the right, and you can move things. And you can again pick by how much you move in different units. Scale, rotate, and skew. Let's skew it. Not working quite as too much. Oh, degrees. That's strange. Oh, there we go. I forgot to apply. That's a stupid mistake, sorry. And I don't even know what the matrix does, but never mind. Another thing that we have in the objects tab that applies to everything, all of the different shapes you can make, is the fill and stroke. All of these are open here on the side. Let's make a circle. All right. Quite straightforward. You can change the color of the fill, the stroke, and the stroke style. So you can pick from the bottom here, or you can just make your own color. That's the fill. Let's change the stroke. Let's make it red. Yeah. And stroke style. I mean, this is the same as in most other programs, drawing programs, right? But you also have gradients. So for example, instead of having that weird color like a full normal, you can set up a gradient, a linear gradient or a radial gradient or some patterns, which I never use, so I can't really tell you much about them. And you can adjust these gradients they also have handles. So you can basically decide where that gradient starts and ends. So if you don't, made another circle. Not that one, this one. It's easier when I look at the computer and not there. So you can move this around and just have a little bit of a gradient or something. Yeah. So there we have the gradients. And another cool thing that I really like, especially when I'm aligning plots together or whatever, when you want things to be in the same like horizontal position or something, you can of course adjust the position of every single object very precisely. Up there you have the x, the horizontal and the vertical coordinates, the width and the height, and you can adjust it very precisely down to the pixel. But let's say you have a couple of weird little squares and you want them to be all in one line. So you have the align and distribute, and then we can just select all of them. And let's have them all flushed to the left. Or we can have them centered. And then on top of that, we can put them down on the same level. So now that wasn't that useful, but when you want to put things, for example, on the same level like that, it's quite easy to do it like so. Yeah. You can also set that the distances between them are that they're equidistant, and that's there, so that the spaces between them are equal. And wow, I'm making really ugly rectangles now.
It's the stroke.
It's not good, is it? Let's change it to normal. Looks a bit better, but the color is still a bit not important. All right, you can group things together. You go to object and group, and since I do that a lot, then I do remember the keyboard shortcut for it, and you can ungroup them. So now they move together. I think it's the same in PowerPoint. Yeah. the what I wanted to also talk about is the Z order, which means which ones you see, which ones are on top of other ones, and that you can also easily control in the Objects tab by raising or lowering each object. And a nice thing, let's raise this one so we can see it. Oh, it's because of the gradient. That is there. So now I hid the little square under, right? And then you want to select it without moving the ellipse, right? And then you can't. And then it's annoying. And you know it's there because when you select everything, you see it. But you still can't click on it. And that's when alt clicking comes in. So when you press alt and you click the first time, it selects the topmost object. When you click again, it selects the one underneath. Oops. Yeah, okay, let's try again. Now we can move it. I believe there's a thing for how you can actually, that you don't have to move, because now I moved it with the arrows, but I think you can hold onto it somehow, but I forgot how. Yeah, and the last thing that is really useful and that I didn't know about for a long time is clipping and masking. Can you do that in PowerPoint? I guess you, I don't know. I don't use PowerPoint anymore, I use this. Masking, not that much, but clipping is a really cool thing. And so let's say you have an object, and I'm gonna change the color because I'm getting a bit sick of it. Better? Should I pick something from these? Ooh, no. All right, let's stay with this one. And you want to cut out a piece of it. And there is no obvious way of how to do that. But what you can do is, let's say we want to cut out a little square, and I'm gonna change this one so that it only stays like that. Ooh, what have I done now? Okay, so let's say that we don't want the whole circle, we just want that part that is within this little square. Or it happens that, I don't know, you import some figure from somewhere and you want just a part of it and not the whole thing. So this is the way to fix that. So I'll just copy this so that you see how they look like. So now you pick the object that you want to cut something out of, and then you click on then you select also the path that is supposed to do the cutting. You select multiple things by holding the shift when you're clicking. And then we have object, clip, set. And then you're left with the part of the circle that you wanted. And it works as a new object, so you don't really see the initial circle or anything. And you can, of course, undo it by going back to clip, set, clip and release. And what have I done? That didn't work. There. Yeah. So, and masking is similar, but it doesn't use the path of the clipping path, but it uses the gradient of that object or of that path. So if we fill this rectangle with some gradient, so you see that the gradient is, it's lighter on the right and more on the left. So let's cut out this thing. I'll copy it again so that, and there. And this time let's do the mask. Sorry. Interesting. No. That's strange. What am I doing different?
Selection order menu.
Oh no, I don't have them both. It should be first the object you want to cut and then the path. Wow, okay, that's confusing. Let's try the other way. No idea. There shouldn't be great. I mean, it's the.
It worked when you showed me.
Yeah. It always works. Why doesn't it work now? Yeah. Okay, let's try when there's no gradient, then it should pick the whole thing. Just like, just similar to the clipping. And it doesn't. All right, that's a mystery. I'm sorry. I guess we'll move on. That was weird. Never mind.
It works for
you. So what's it supposed to do?
It works for you?
Yes.
Do I have some weird settings here that I didn't notice? All right. Okay. Now I'm really. There. And let's try again to make a square.
Give it a radial gradient.
Sure. I'll give it a radial gradient. And I'll move it on there. There it is. So, yeah, it's very light. Let's make it a bit different. Yeah, I guess I can give it a stroke and that should help. Can we make it a bit? Yeah, like that. Hopefully we'll be more visible. Yeah, so there you can see that what we are left with from that original ellipse is just the part of it with the gradient applied. So where the gradient is, where it's the darkest, you get the most of the original object. And it's, yeah. And where it's lightest, you have almost nothing. So from the red, circle, we have this. All right. I have no idea why it didn't work before. Okay. So there are some special things you can do with each of these shape tools. And I'm going to show you some of them now. And we'll start with... Actually, I should leave myself some space for drawing. We start with the rectangles. So let's make a rectangle. And I talked about these two handles, the square ones that just reshape. But you also have a little circular one. And if you grab that one and pull, you get rounded corners. And if there's actually two of them, but they're usually underneath each other. So if you take the other one, then you can make rounded corners that are not symmetrical. Yeah. So you can adjust. You can also adjust this radius of curvature up in the toolbar, so you can control it quite precisely. And then you can also undo it up there to make corners sharp again. And if you're making a lot of rectangles and you want to keep them the same, the rounded corners, you want them to be the same. Because, for example, if you're making a flowchart, you want your squares to stay similar even when you fit in different amount of text, right? They're different sizes, but the corners should still look the same throughout. So if you go to the selector tool, you have these icons on top right. If you hover over them, they tell you what they're doing. This one, when scaling objects, scale the stroke with by the same proportion. Let's switch that off. And let's switch the, when scaling rectangles, scale the radii of rounded corners. No, we don't want to scale them now. So when we, let's make another identical rectangle. And let's make this one bigger. And you see it keeps the corner and the stroke width the same as it was before. Because if we switch this on again so that it rescales, then you don't get the same stuff. Like it rounds it more, it makes it thicker, all of that. So that's a really neat thing to know, which I didn't for a long time. Yeah, but this is really helpful. Because otherwise, I was always setting it manually, like how much rounded corners I want. But but this lets you do it automatically. OK, so that was the cool thing about rectangles. Now let's go to the cool thing about ellipses. Which is also awesome to know. And I think I'll change the color again, because I'm getting tired of the... Oh, that's the stroke. The stroke should be black, right? That's the proper color for the stroke. Ooh. Okay. Yeah. So again, you have the two square handles that resize things. And then you have the mysterious round handle that does this. It makes Pac-Man. You can also control exactly what the angles are up in the toolbar again. And make Pac-Man, right? So if you're dragging the mouse on the outside of the circle, you get segments, you get the Pac-Man. If you go inwards, you get arcs. So when I was making smiley faces, I didn't have to do any clipping, any cutting of the circles. You just do this. Not that I'd make that many smiley faces for, but you know. Yeah, so this is really useful. Ooh. And yeah, you have the toolbar where you can set it more precisely and make it whole again. So, now we get to the funniest bit of Inkscape. That is, I guess there is some use for it in our work as well, but not that much. At least I don't use them for actual work, but they're awesome. So you have stars and polygons. So I started with a polygon. Up, you can pick if you have polygons or stars. So I'll switch it to a star. Oh, now I can't. Like so. Ooh, okay. Let's draw another one. Too big. There's a star. You can change the number of corners. You can change set of the spoke ratio. And then you have some fun stuff you can do, again, by dragging the handles. So the outer handle on the tip of the star, it's not that interesting. But the inner one, now it comes. OK? And then you can rotate. Right? It's pretty awesome. I encourage everyone to try that, because it's really therapeutical. Okay, and apart from that, you can also, if you shift and drag the handle, you will round the corners. Oi! It's a bit difficult to control, but you also can control it up in the bar again, so let's try to do it slowly. Rounding them a bit more. Oh, it's pretty, isn't it? And then you also have an option to randomize. And that's using Alt and drag. But as with the rounding, if I do that, it just goes too crazy too quickly. So if we do it up slowly. Ooh. Right. So I mean, how useful this is for your figures, I don't know. It's fun though. But for example, if you make if you need blobs, right? If you're drawing cells or something that should be a bit, you know, organic looking, then for example, making a rectangle, not a star, but a rectangle that is slightly, yeah, we still have the randomization going on. I mean, you can make pretty weird blobs quite easily. Probably useful. Yeah. So that was the stars and polygons and blobs. And then there are also spirals, which I think are even less useful. But let's make one. Ooh. I should resize this to normal. Okay, let's try another one. Ah, there it is. Okay, there we have a spiral. The handles allow you to add more turns from inside or outside. And if you hold Alt and drag the inner handle, then they diverge or converge. You can also control all of this like more precisely. Yeah, and Shift and outer handle just resizes it as it should. Yeah, but these are probably less interesting for us. Fun. Okay, so that was shapes. Where am I? Shapes. And let's move to the other basic thing you can draw in Inkscape, and that's paths. And I guess you're a bit familiar with them from PowerPoint, for example. But that was what confused me in Inkscape for the first time when I tried it. Because the how do I make a line problem, right? So you have two different tools. You have the pen and the pencil on the left there. The pencil is freehand drawing. And I don't know how about you, but when I'm doing my figures, the only thing I have available is the mouse. And how nicely I can draw something with the mouse is a bit difficult to say. But I often need squiggly lines because I work with polymers, right? And how does a polymer look like on schematics? Squiggly line. Because it's, yeah, organic stuff usually. So I find myself using this pencil tool actually quite often. So I just draw a squiggly line, and it's not pretty enough, but then you can simplify it. Either you go to path and simplify, or that is a keyboard shortcut that I do remember, Control L, and you click it a few times, and the faster you're clicking, the more rapid the simplification is. And you see, it's quite a lot smoother now than it was. So what it's doing is basically removing nodes. You can do it in PowerPoint, but manually. Here you can do it by, you know, woodpecking on the Control L. Or just holding it, yeah. So let's have a look at the nodes. So you can either double click on the path, or you can switch to this node editing tool on the left, and then you can move around each of the nodes separately and change your path. And you have these handles that allow you to control the curvature. So you also have tools up in the bar. You can add and remove nodes. You can make them symmetrical, and so on. So if we pick all of them and use the auto smooth, then we get something which looks quite pretty, I guess, for a squiggly line. So I actually use this quite a lot. And the pen tool basically creates the same kind of thing, the same path, but you control the placement of each node separately. So if we go to the pen, and then you just click, and you click, and you click, and then you double click to finish it, or press enter to finish it. And then you can go to the node editing tool and just and then you just do whatever you need to do with each node. All of the shapes that we talked about before, they can be turned into paths. So you can make a circle, and then you go to path, objects to path, and then you can edit the nodes. You can add nodes. And I'll add another one. And you can do stuff. However, this is irreversible. Once you change a shape to a path, you can't go back. So now, like, I can't make a Pac-Man anymore. You know, you can't use these special features of the circle anymore, because it's not a circle anymore. And you can even change stroke of each object into its own path and edit that. So you could basically make a stroke that has different width in different parts, or just edit that as well. Then there are, I guess I'll clean it up a bit. Then we have in the path, you have some Boolean operations like union, difference, intersection. So if you want, you just, I mean, it's basically what it says it is. So you just have two paths, and you can just get there the difference between them, and it creates the necessary nodes where the paths overlap, and you get a new path. I don't actually use these things much because I don't know. And then another thing I would like to show you, and I have to draw something for that. Let's make it a bit prettier. I don't know if this is the best shape to show it on, but there is something they call inset and outset. Let's change this one to red first, so that you can, okay. So now I have two of these exact same paths, one black one on the bottom, and then an identical one, a red one on top. And I'm gonna, with the red one, I'll do a dynamic offset. So I just grab the handle, and you can go in or out of your previous shape. You can also do this with, we have it, that's blocked. Oh, I wanted a nice star, and this is what I get. There. Okay, let's make it a star. Let's duplicate. So let's try with this one. Yeah, I didn't even need to switch it to a... I should make this one empty. So again, I have two on top of each other. So now I'm just moving the outer one. So you can go, it's a bit difficult to get it precisely. Let's zoom in. So now we have a star with rounded corners without much effort. Or we can go in. And now you have rounded insides. Yeah, so that's inset and outset. I'll leave these here. They're pretty. Okay, and of course you can insert text into your pictures, which you probably have already noticed since there are a lot of text. So let's just, yeah, that's very straightforward. You're just right here, right? And you can change the font, change the size. There's superscripts and subscripts, which can be nice. Cool thing is you can also flow the text into a path. So let's make some path. And let's put this text on the text. And there you have put on path. Yeah. And that's actually what I did with the title here. And you can also control the spacing between the letters. So you can get them. Then again, you have to make sure you're in the right tool if you want to do this because the selector or the text, they give you different options of how to change this text. But here you have, where is it? This is the, yeah, that's the spacing between letters. So we can increase it. A bit too much. We can make them a bit tighter. And you can also do it for each gap, especially. So if you want to make some logos or stuff, I guess this would be a useful tool. Yeah, and the last thing I want to show you is the diagram connectors, which are the last thing on the left bottom. And let's just make some Didn't I pick, oh, rounded corners. I was like, why did I get an ellipse when I picked a rectangle? Okay, so let's say that we're making a flowchart and these are two of the windows. And then we just pick a diagram connector and drag, oh, come on. What have I done now? Ooh, interesting. Okay, let's try again. Diagram connectors. And you know how it is when you're making a presentation and things just don't cooperate. Thank you. That was long delay. Okay, so now they're connected, right? You had those squares in the middle. And then if you move one of them, there's a delay, right? I don't know why. But the connector moves too. And then you can for the connector, you can set it. You can set the curvature, you can make it round. You can make it avoid objects or go in different ways, and yeah, so there's basically, it's made to make flowcharts, which is also something we find ourselves doing, right? At least I do sometimes. Okay, so.
Excuse me?
Yeah.
Can you connect the nodes between two different objects?
That's a good question. Like if you can add like another, a third one, or?
No, just like if you have two objects and you want to connect them with a line or something, but between two nodes, so like nodes on different objects.
Okay.
Just the star.
Yeah, you can connect things that are. Sorry, there we are. I guess they actually go to the middle. So I don't know if you can connect a specific node on an object, but I bet there will be these questions asked on the internet. But no, I never thought about it. I don't know. All right. But thanks for the question. Yeah, that would be good to know. Sorry, I hope no one's getting dizzy by my scrolling. Okay, so that was the basic stuff. The basic tools that you have in Inkscape. And I think with this knowledge, you could probably make most things that you need. So I'm just going to quickly show you what I have made. So here is one of my pictures. Polymers, right? Squiggly lines with some DNA double helices in between. So making the double helix was actually quite easy, because it was just, I just made like a zigzag with the pen and then edited each node to make it smooth. And if you switch on the grid, and then you can snap the handles of those of the curvature to the same. So it was easy to get them the same, all of them. Then I just copied it, and suddenly you have like a ribbon, right? I make two of them, and just you can control the position of everything so precisely that it's really easy to get it looking as you want to. Yeah, and here I actually had multiple layers because I wanted to keep the three of these separate while I was working on them. So because I was worried that I would mess up another one, but I mean that's not really necessary actually. But it was still nice. So yeah, the squiggly lines were the usual, just freehand and then simplified. I was accused that all of my random squiggly lines look like letters. This looks like Y, this looks like L. And I have to admit it does, and this looks like Z. But, you know, what can you do? one thing I didn't mention yet is, like, what if you want to fill a path with a color? Because sometimes if you just make a path, let's make a random one again, and you even join it, and now you want to fill the whole thing with some color. But it's not always what you expect, right? Because they overlap. So what you can do is do it manually, and you have this bucket on the left, and you just pour the colors in. But now we have it without fill. Okay, there. So you can fill anything. And by this, you create new objects that have stroke and fill, and you can move them around. So we can take that one out. Also, usually when you do this, it's good to be zoomed in a bit, because sometimes you might be left with, like, if I do it like this, this E. Oh, actually, it was a hole. You will have nicer edges the closer you are, because, I mean, it's the scalable vectors. Okay, so that's also what I used when working on these, to get the right colors on the parts of the spiral where I wanted them. Yeah, and then I found out that people were always frowning when I had this picture on presentations. So I was redoing it to make it a bit simpler. So I removed the fancy double helices, but now at least people understood better what was going on. And here I want to make a short tangent about one of the things that I've been trying to do. And actually, there are so many people here. Is there anyone here who's colorblind? Yeah. How are those free colors? Like, are they discernible? Yeah, because you know how it is. I don't know how about you, but when I need three different colors that are very different, you don't pick yellow, right? Because yellow doesn't print that well and it's a bit too light. You go for red, green, and blue. And then you're like, oops, right? The red and green. And there's this website, this color brewer, that I really like when I want to pick a color scheme. And you can make them colorblind safe. And for example, qualitative, and you probably recognize these three, because I use them all the time now, in the hopes that everyone will be able to see what I'm trying to show. Yeah. So that was some schematics. Here, this is drawn in Inkscape, quite simple. This is from a microscope. So as long as you make sure that the resolution of your picture that you import is good enough for the size you will need it at, then you can import pictures. This is from MATLAB. So actually, MATLAB can save figures as SVG files. So you can scale them in Inkscape without getting the blurring. And Python can do it too. I don't know about other programs, but these are the ones I use. When I need to put in, you know, one figure, some pictures and a plot, and you want to make it into one figure for a paper, then I use Inkscape. And then I can easily, you know, set the quality for the output file. Yeah, this is the same thing. It's MATLAB figures that are just put together. And yeah, I also made the poster that you already saw, and that basically contains all of these different things. And it looks very different now. But that's all from me, and I hope that after this now I can stand up. And I hope that after this you will be able to use this and you don't have to do things in paint anymore. Thank you for your attention. This was really fun.
Yes, thank you, Eleanor. So as I said at the beginning, you spend a lot of time drawing pictures in this job. And a lot of times I've been using PowerPoint. This is very similar, but it makes a lot of things easier. And my students should pay attention because I would like them to do all their figures now on it. So are there any pressing questions? I see Baki has his hand up.
What about equations? Do I have to import them as external files?
Yeah, as far as I know.
You can also there, you have extensions and there is one equation.
There is an, there are some cool extensions, many of them. Some of them work better, some of them work worse, but I'm just being told there is one for... I don't know, so, it's not quite there, but yeah, I guess importing them would be the only option if there's no, but.
There is an extension, there is? I don't remember what it's called, but you can type in LaTeX.
Okay,
there's
yeah.
LaTeX extension.
Yeah, there's a, what was it, text?
Is it render or in typography?
Should be under render.
Should be under render? I know. Yeah, there are so many extensions in
there. Yeah, that or on typography.
Alphabet soup, that's gotta be it. That's what his equation is, isn't it?
I wonder what that is.
Hopefully.
Randomized.
Maybe not.
Okay.
For the dyslexic. I'm colorblind.
Let's see what happens. I've never tried this before. Okay, what did it do? Okay, yeah, there are a lot of extensions, and I believe you when you say that there is one for equations for LaTeX, so, and that's actually good to know. Probably Googleable quite easily. Yeah.
There. Okay, one more question, then we eat. Yes.
Okay. In some drawing programs, there is a possibility to go back in history, like that they saved what you've done, like last 20, 30 steps. Do you know if there's something like this in this one?
I don't know. I never...
It's sometimes very useful. You play around and then you realize it's total mess and then you just go back.
Well, you have the undo button that, for me, so far, it always worked as far back as I needed it.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, just playing around with it now, it has undo history, and it seems to have saved everything I've done.
Okay. Yeah.
You can configure how many steps you want to save.
Oh, okay.
So it's dependent on memory. You can do infinite if you want.
Yeah. But by default, it's saving quite a bit because I never had a problem with running out of undo.
Wonderful. So let's thank Eleonora one more time. So please, as a reward for coming here and learning something, we've bought you some pizza. So just help yourself in the back, and it's so crowded.